Hey, everybody. Everybody doing good? Everybody ate? Yeah?
Good. Everybody asleep from lunch? You like that? You get the first session after lunch, everybody's in a meat coma from all the barbecue.
That's right.
It's gonna be awesome.
But you know, as they say, you know, when you're in Texas, do the barbecue. So thank you very much for coming, first of all. My name is Sean Rickard. A little bit of an introduction. Yes, I am Canadian. Please do not throw things at me. Some interests of mine, obviously, I'm a big SUSE fan. I do work for the company. I'm big into Linux, obviously OpenStack, or I wouldn't be here. I've traveled quite extensively for both work, and I used to be, I actually used to be in a death metal band, so I know I don't look like it, but it's true. Yeah! Saw the horns in the back there, pretty good. And with me I have Rick Ashford, who is a Texan, which is technically American. Also a big fan of Linux and SUSE and OpenStack. He's also really, really, really good with a barbecue. I mean, like, he had us over at his house yesterday.
I was really good at picking up the phone and ordering it. And then I drove all the way over there and watched them cut it so I could pick it up and bring it home.
See, that's awesome. So we got a really good set of information here for you guys. So we are going to be talking about implementing OpenStack in a legacy environment. Without further ado, I'll pass it over to Rick.
All right, thank you very much. Well, when we first walked into this room, I at first was like, wow, somebody is way more optimistic than I am that people are going to be interested in hearing what we have to say, you know, because I marked this as a beginner level course session. So I'm very excited to see so many people here. Can I repeat excited a couple times? Sounds
sure.
Like a bad presenter? Presenter? Eesh. All right. Apparently, if you eat, you can't talk either. All right.
I blame the tasty, tasty barbecue sauce that we had.
Yeah. There we go. All right. IT and their end users. Typically, this is not the best relationship you have in the world, right? Nobody calls up IT saying, hey, you guys did a great job today. All that server uptime, awesome. Right? Usually you get the lynch mob coming because you had 3 seconds of outage on your Exchange server and it happened to coincide with when people were trying to coordinate their fantasy football or their NCAA betting bracket for the tournament. And so at this point you are the source of all evil on the planet and they wish that you would be destroyed.
And by the way, depending on your position in your enterprise, you get to decide which side you're on.
That's right. Sometimes you can say that's the management in the center and the IT people want to go kill them as well. So there's a lot of different ways you can go with this. But the point being here is that, you know, ideally everybody has, the reason that everybody gets mad at IT is because IT has to exert a lot of control over the infrastructure and a lot of control over the way that people do their jobs. And it's just necessary in order to bring order to the chaos. Ideally, from an IT standpoint, you would have this wonderful homogeneous data center. Everything is all one hardware platform. Everything is all one operating system. SUSE, of course, right? You're all in the room? Okay. and all that kind of wonderful stuff. But unfortunately, we don't live in that kind of a clean, you know, that particular unicorn does not exist. Does anybody here have a completely homogeneous data center? Raise your hand. Okay, good.
Nobody has the unicorn?
We're all honest. I did have somebody raise that once, but it turned out he was like he was starting his own company like that week, so he had no infrastructure, so everything was the same. I wanted to throw something at him. All right, this is what your traditional IT environment really looks like, right? You don't have that single clean one thing of truth. You have a jumbled mess of a lot of different things that hurts your eyes to look at it, and you try not to think about it in great detail. All the time.
Not only that, but off the screen, you can't see it, but you actually have a raptor riding a shark with laser beam on its head. It's actually pretty cool. I wish we had the panorama of it, but
yeah,
next time.
There's only so much you can get in that 4:3 aspect ratio. All right. There we go. Okay. So you're bringing OpenStack into your big jumbled mess of an environment. You know, ideally you can go in and rip everything out and re-implement everything, but again, that is not a realistic way of going about business. In real life, you have things like hardware or software that somebody in management decided that you had to buy, And you cannot buy anything or do anything different with it until you go through the complete cycle and it fails miserably, and then they can go and buy something else that you don't want.
And real quick, just to make this an interactive session, as he's talking about certain things, if you've experienced this, just raise your hand.
Anybody? We have a lot of dishonest. There we go. Okay,
yeah,
there's a lot more
better.
Honesty right there. I've been on the IT side of this, and then I hate using the word sales engineers because it sounds like we're salespeople, but we're not. As a systems engineer consulting with our customers, how about that?
There you go.
I have had customers say, "Yeah, your products are fantastic. We really want to use them, but they just bought this right here, so we have to wait 6 months so that the project can blow up and die, and the manager will get moved over to something else, and then we can go do what we really want to do." So, okay. So, more real life, right? You have your standardized virtualization platform, whether that's VMware, KVM, whatever, right? And that is your gold standard, and that's what everything's on, right? Except for when the Windows people say, "Hey, we got to do Hyper-V because we don't want to have incremental costs for the spinning up Windows workloads." And then you have the developers over in this section that say, "Screw it, I don't want to deal with VMware. I'm going to do my own KVM stuff because I'm awesome, and I know better than everybody in IT." Not that I've ever met a developer or been a developer like that. And then you have the we bought one of everything mentality, which is when you get to the really, really, really big, Fortune 2, Fortune 5 type companies, they just go buy everything underneath the sun, and then they'll figure it out later. And it's up to you to figure it, to work with them to figure out something that's going to actually be usable from all this mishmash of weird stuff.
So then, as Rick was talking about, you end up with something like this. You got your guys that are saying, "Oh yeah, no, we've got some System Z machines out there running our mainframes, and we're running ZVM on there, and oh, we've got some Microsoft boxes over here, and you know we're running all Hyper-V there, and oh, but we got some Hewlett Packard ProLiant boxes, and we got VMware, of course, and
we had that one box in the corner that's covered with dust that somebody set it up 6 months ago and left the company 4 months ago, and nobody knows what it is.
That's it, but everything's running on SUSE. Well, no, that'd be a wonderful thing. I mean, some companies even have hats. Yeah, it should have been like that. There you go. Hats, but that's not the right type of hat. Yeah, that's closer to it.
Yeah. There you go. Very cute. That he was so proud of that artwork. He did that all by himself.
I was giddy. It was fun. So talking about security, obviously, most companies, I would hope to say all companies, already have security platforms or security
procedures.
Procedures, thank you very much. And this is what you get for having a guy that's actually French first on stage. and you've got your certifications, you got your things that you're talking about. Now, moving everything over to an OpenStack cloud, the good thing is that you don't really have to change much. I mean, there's some things that are going to be changing. You know, you're going to be handling your tenancy differently to do access privileges. You can do multi-domain to further separate things. You can do zones, you can do all those fun things. But, you know, ideally you're going to want to encrypt all your traffic, and then there's multiple ways that you can do that. You can do TLS stuff between your instances and your outbound stuff and your physical servers that are already existing. You want to bring in your single sign-ons, like, there's always the guy that's like, "Oh yeah, no, we got everything on Active Directory." Bring it in. It's definitely doable. We're going to be talking about that in a little bit as well. And one of the big things that you're definitely going to want to think about is having a centralized patching system. So for us at SUSE, we have something called SUSE Manager.
We're creative with our names.
Yes, we are. And one of the great things with it is that you can actually do CVE auditing with it. So, you know, you're going to be able to check all your instances, see which ones are vulnerable to certain vulnerabilities, and then patch them directly from one tool. There's more than just our tool available to do that, and whatever is already in your environment could be a good idea to use. And then obviously, since OpenStack is open source, you can use things like SC Linux and AppArmor to further harden your instances, as well as your control nodes, your compute nodes, and your admin nodes.
Yeah. So let's talk a little bit about, so who here, and we're going to try to make this a little bit interactive, so who here has the IT Nazi department from, the security group, sorry, we're not necessarily the IT, but who has the security group from hell, Nazis, if enforce everything that
you can't come on, there's more than that.
Walk to the bathroom without getting clearance.
Okay, there you go.
More than that. Okay.
All right, do you guys have that little RSA thing where, you know, you, as you said, when you're going to the bathroom, you actually have to type into the pad, and, you know, it's like, I really have to go, no. Yeah. Are we the only
ones? You got to have it on the door to the bathroom and on the stall.
Yes, absolutely.
Okay. So those guys, there's a wide range in the aggressiveness, shall we say, of the security groups that are out there. And this is one of those things that you need to start and planning ahead of time very strongly. And backing up for half a second, the when you're going out to deploy OpenStack, who here has actually deployed OpenStack out to production? Okay, that's more hands than I thought.
Bad.
Why are you here? I'm glad you're here, don't get me wrong, you've already encountered some of these things, and actually when we get to the end of this, we've left time at the end so that people, we do have these microphones here, if people want to share their stories, horror stories, war stories, or things that they've run into that they want to help other people avoid, we want to hear those kinds of things. We hear the things that we talk to about with our customers, but we don't necessarily know, well, I'll admit it, I don't know everything. I'd love to hear what you had to say.
And if any of you guys actually have a story about that magical pink unicorn, we want to hear it.
Yeah, it's not there.
I know. Okay. Another thing to you mentioned.
I was still halfway through my thought. And
okay,
I just
go ahead.
I forgot. Did you like this? Okay. So you've got the wide range of security teams, right? From the ultra paranoid, you can't even go to the bathroom without swiping a key card, to the people that are just basically, you know,
sitting in the closet,
whoever's
enjoying
there in the coffee
certain substances that they shouldn't be.
Where did you work before this?
Lots of places.
Apparently so. But you also have like the extreme opposite end where you have like the people in a coffee shop that are using the free Wi-Fi access point and who knows who's snooping in on their traffic and all that kind of fun stuff. So there's a wide range of going on in there. And the reason that I'm bringing this up is because the vast majority of your time in getting to your OpenStack deployment is not going to be done in actually deploying OpenStack. That is actually one of the fastest and most easy things to do, at least with our stuff, it is. There's lots of deployment frameworks to help out there to help you get out there really fast. The vast majority of your time is going to be spent in conference rooms and dealing with people like the security teams to be able to negotiate out how this cloud is going to come into your environment. And this is where you get into the whole everybody is in sales kind of thing. Even if you are an IT person, if you're a on that security team, if you're in operations, whatever you're doing, you need to be able to sell and understand not only how these things are going to impact you, but how these things are going to impact the other teams, the other people that have interests in how your cloud comes out.
And that's actually a good point. He's talking about basically planning. Depending on what type of enterprise you are and what your focus is, your little worries might be just script kiddies. Your worries might be actual, motivated people that actually know their stuff. If you're working in government, you're looking at, potentially hardening your cloud against other states or other governments. So you have to really talk to the whole organization as a whole and figure out what your threats are, what type of level you're looking at, and what you need to do to actually get it hardened to a satisfying level.
Yep. And do the whole risk cost analysis stuff of, if it costs you $5 million to secure $1 million worth of data, that's not a very good strategy.
No.
So the point is that you're going to have to negotiate these types of things, and there's lots of different pieces. And we've listed out a couple of these things right here. In some cases, you'll have your company policies will require that you encrypt everything in sight, right? Well, there's trade-offs, right? Because security is all about a trade-off between security versus convenience, right? So you need to decide where you want to allow things. Did that even sound vaguely coherent? Okay, let's try that again. So you need to decide what your particular level of paranoia is and what particular level of paranoia you can get sold up the chain. And where this comes into play is, for example, with encrypting your traffic, right? Is encrypting traffic a good thing? Yes.
Yeah. Come on, this is interactive, people.
Let's yes, go. Okay. is encrypting, do you need to encrypt all of your traffic? No!
Yes, there thank you. Go.
That's much better. All right, so there are reasons for not encrypting all of your traffic, right? If you're trying to monitor the traffic and maintain the cloud internally, you don't necessarily want to have all that encrypted. You want to have it segmented off so that other people can't get into it and look at it. But you don't necessarily need to have it encrypted. If you can isolate all that traffic and keep things away from it, it'll make your life as an operator trying to debug and find where something went wrong significantly easier than if you have to intercept encrypted SSL streams and then install the keys and decrypt them and all that kind of stuff. It's just a lot of extra time, and especially if you're under a time crunch to get an issue resolved, you need to make sure that you have the appropriate level of responsiveness via your security choices.
I mean, if you want to go really deep into it, then you can talk about instance entropy and hardware number random number generators and all that fun stuff, but then you're going really, really deep, and we're not going to talk about that today. So going on, existing authentication network. You know, I talked about, you know, the guy says, oh yeah, no, we have Active Directory already existing.
So let's do a quick poll. Who here has Active Directory? I don't even know what we do. Okay. Open LDAP? Okay, we used to be owned by Novell and we hate it, but who here had eDirectory? Any way, shape, or form?
I am so sorry.
The one guy over there in the corner. Okay. He's a good guy.
We like him. At least he's honest. So.
That's right. What's that? Oh, had it. Okay. There you go. Yeah, there's a lot of people that had it. that's why there's no Novell anymore.
Yes.
Okay. So there's a wide variety of different platforms, and you need to be able to integrate into that.
So the too long didn't read version, which who here does it? Everybody should be raising their hands. There, a couple of honest people. You want to leverage your hybrid authentication driver. That's going to be the first thing. This was introduced back in OpenStack Juno. So now we are on, currently on non-Liberty and coming up with
Mintaka.
Mintaka, yeah. So it's a few versions ago. And your authentication equals LDAP, Open LDAP, Active Directory. Yeah. I mean, the main things that you want to talk about is that there's a few considerations when talking about implementing Active Directory. There's a couple of steps that you need to do that are actually all outlined on the OpenStack security guide, and we have actually a SUSE documentation there that goes along with it. Okay. But you have to change a couple of little sections. You have to make sure that group of names is usable, otherwise it's not going to work.
Right. And the key thing here is the hybrid authentication driver, for those of you who have not played with that yet, basically enables you to do the authentication against your existing LDAP framework, but then store all the metadata that's unique to OpenStack inside of your local cloud.
Yeah.
And that enables you to integrate with the outside world, but then you don't have to alter the schema of the LDAP store that you're using to be able to add in all this extra information that you need to know for OpenStack.
Yeah, one of the very important things, you have to make sure that you have the right permissions to actually access those things, because if you don't, you're going to hit a brick wall. Yep. And the cloud moves fast, and you don't want to hit a brick wall at 100 miles an hour.
Yep. All right, storage. Who here has storage in their environment? Come on. All right, there we go.
If there's anybody that did not raise their hand, there's a really issue.
If you want to alternate hands when you're doing that, you can get some good exercise. Okay, so the big thing with storage is when you're implementing something that's as significantly different as OpenStack is into your environment, you have the ability to start over in some cases or reuse existing equipment, right? So this is where you need to start getting into the planning with your storage team of saying, you know, what are our long-term goals for storage? Do we want to take advantage of this opportunity to slip some object-based storage or, you know, some software-defined storage into here, whether that's Swift or whether that's Ceph, whether it's any of the other object stores and whatnot that are out there. This is when you would need to make those decisions. And this is also when you get into the whole negotiating with management, where they made their hardware decisions and they need you to justify it, so you can't throw out the sand yet.
Like that guy that bought the tape drive 6 months ago, even though it's, you know, antiquated technology.
Somebody bought a tape drive? They do still do that. I actually have a lot of customers that still use tapes.
See?
What?
See?
There you go. Okay. So storage. So you'll need to stop and think about what are your long-term goals for storage. And that's going to impact a lot of different things, right? You want to look at how you're going to optimize storage. What are you optimizing for? If you are optimizing for performance, that's going to be one thing. You'll likely have a nice big SAN with lots of really fast spinning drives. You'll probably have some SSDs in there and do some cache tiering and all that kind of fun stuff. Versus if you're doing, you're optimizing for
security,
storage density, or you know something like that, you'll have different hardware profiles that are coming in here. And the reason that we keep that we're going over this is simply because there's usually not one single storage solution that you have in your company. There's usually 5, 6, 7, 8. You'll have the stuff you bought from one vendor one time, and then you have the other stuff you bought once that stuff was obsoleted, but nobody got rid of it, and so now it's being used by somebody else. You'll have all these pieces in here, and you need to decide which ones of those you want to incorporate into your OpenStack strategy.
And so going along with that, who here has like different vendor storage solutions in their enterprise right now? Quite a bit of you, right? You know, some of it's CMC, some of it's NetApp, some of it is Rackspace or... not Rackspace, but it'll come back to me. I'll probably interject in the middle of his talk with a random brand, exactly. But it's going
to
come.
The big benefit, really, to OpenStack in this case is that if you have all these random bits of equipment, and you know, Cinder can operate multiple backends at one time, so you can actually stick all this stuff in there together, and you don't necessarily have to worry about having that single common platform. You can have multiple backends in there that that Cinder can do, and it really OpenStack in general. Like the biggest thing. And this was talked about briefly this morning. And by the way, part of the reason that we're going quicker and pace-wise than what we were planning is because a lot of the stuff that we had in here was covered in the keynotes this morning.
Yeah.
And so we're shortening and compressing it a little bit just so we don't do too much redundancy. And I just completely lost my train of thought as I was going. What was I talking about?
Talking about storage.
Storage. Thanks, guys. Oh, I know what it is. So you can stick all these different pieces underneath a single storage umbrella. So if you have the EMC and the Equalogic and whatever NetApp, you can stick that all underneath there. The big benefit to OpenStack in general is simply that you have this common point of integration for so many things. You know, at traditional IT, you walk in and you buy the NetApp, then you need to have all the tools for NetApp, right? And they all have to you have to write all of your stuff to be able to leverage those. And then when you go buy another tool, Equalogic or EMC or whatever, then you have to get the tooling for those and you have to rejigger all of your scripts to use those. The big benefit for OpenStack in general is that you can, by bringing these all underneath the OpenStack API, then all of a sudden you only have to write your stuff one time and then it can go to all these different platforms seamlessly to the end user. And so you don't have to sit there and continuously be rewriting things whenever you decide you want to make changes to your environment. From a hypervisor standpoint, if you're already running out VMware in production, a lot of times you'll run into people in the OpenStack community that are going to the whole point of going to OpenStack is to get rid of VMware, so we need to be able to you want to get rid of that, right? Well, realistically, in your enterprise, you can't just pick up and rip out your entire production VMware environment and replace it with KVM. It's a non-starter. So the benefit to OpenStack is that you can take a portion of that VMware and put that up into OpenStack and have that be managed by OpenStack, but then you can add in the other pieces as well. If you want to have your KVM or Xen or we've got Hyper-V as well up here. You can also do now ZVM. Does anybody here have a mainframe? Just curiosity.
Oh, we've
got a couple of people.
Good.
All right, yeah. Good. We like the mainframe, guys. mainframe, Docker, all these different options that are out there. nice thing is you can have all those hypervisors, all those platforms underneath OpenStack, and you can write your single scripts against the OpenStack API. And then if you decide to shift resources from one hypervisor to the other, if you decide to add in more KVM and take away from VMware, there's absolutely no change to the end users. So at that point, you get a write once, and then you can, from the operational standpoint underneath that, you can try different platforms with reduced risk, right? If you want to try out a new hypervisor, you simply add it in, and you can only, only shuttle a couple of workloads over there so that you can test that out. If you like it, you can add more to it. If you don't, you take it away, and everything's transparent to the end users.
And that goes along with the whole message of today. You know, your legacy environment, your current environment has stuff already there. Why not use it?
So one of the things that it already has is existing workloads. So, ideal world, you'd have this, you'd be able to just scrap everything you've got and rebuild from scratch. And sometimes it's nice to get that clean start. I have one very large company who has been featured at a keynote here in the past, who is doing a complete revamping of systems such that their current builds for their OS and everything like that has a lot of accumulated cruft from over the years. They basically wrote the stuff initially 10 years ago, and they would just kind of keep piling more duct tape and more stuff on top of it until they've got to this point right now where, when you boot up a system, there's about 10 different fatal errors that flash by and nobody pays any attention to anymore because nobody knows what they're for, and so they can't be that important if it doesn't impact your daily life. And all these kind of things. And there's lots of times where you do have that accumulation, and it's really nice to have that break in the line that OpenStack can provide to be able to roll out and do a complete clean build. That's nice. In reality, that's not going to happen all that terribly much. For the most part, you've got all these existing workloads that are already out there on your in your virtualization infrastructure, or sometimes physical infrastructure, and your end users want to be able to continue to use those even if it's inside of your cloud environment. So you're going to need to establish a strategy for going and migrating those in there. It's a fairly simple process. Has anybody done this before? Migrating existing workloads into your OpenStack?
Couple people.
Yeah. Couple people. All right. I was expecting more than that.
Was it very difficult?
Yes.
Oh.
So. It does take a while. There's a number of different ways that you can go about it.
I mean, the TLDR version is snapshot, convert to an image, and then upload it to Glance. Yeah. But that's the easy version.
The easy version that hides away all the nuances is, take the snapshot, convert that over to a disk image, import that into OpenStack, and then relaunch it. The trick is then is depending on how much downtime that particular service is allowed to have. You may not have a long enough service window to be able to do a shut it down and then bring it over and bring it back up. So you'll need to have a policy or a procedure in place for being able to do that cut over to make it as live as possible for that. And that means making sure also that you're migrating data at the same time, bringing over all the data that you need to make sure you have access to that in your cloud environment. And excuse me, I need some water. That's not water.
It's not water, but it's something to drink.
Yeah, that's true. I lost my train of thought again. So you have your existing workloads. So you need to have the procedures to bring those across. if one or two of you that have actually done this before want to share a story about it, I believe the microphone's right here in the middle work. I saw a raised hand over here. Anybody cared to
you
share?
You want to share your story?
More story? What? Oh, NDA story. Oh, those are the best kind.
Yes.
I'll tell you, but I have to kill you. All right. Well, in that case, let's go on to some of the actual more more operational aspects of incorporating these into your OpenStack environment and how this is going to impact the design of your particular cloud. So, for example, if you're going to be leveraging VMware, all the security groups and all that kind of stuff that you're doing in OpenStack are all done via IP tables. There is no IP tables on VMware, and so none of that is going to translate over. So you need to take that into account. You need to have backup plans in terms of firewall setups and whatnot, depending on how big security plays a factor in here, right? Whether you're the ultra
ultra-aggressive. Paranoid or...
We'll say the ultra-aggressive security versus the very lackadaisical kind of thing. The lackadaisical guys will be just like, well, just let all the ports be open. We'll figure it out later. No live migration via OpenStack, right? So if you go and do go into Nova and say, you know, Nova migrate the image, your workload from one to another, that works great on your KVM and Xen. That command does not get translated over to VMware. The way that the VMware driver works is it talks directly to vSphere. You provided your credentials for vSphere, it logs in, and then vSphere has a cluster inside of it that is dedicated to running OpenStack, and it presents that entire cluster to you as this big single entity. So if you have 10 servers in there that have 10 CPUs each, then it'll show you, I have a system here with 100 CPUs and 4 terabytes of RAM or something like that. And then when you submit in your your starting up a virtual machine, it's going to go in there and find a place to stick your virtual machine. So you need to make sure your flavors are not too big for the largest of your of your nodes, your VMware nodes that you're dedicating to this. The VMware nodes that you are putting into the cluster to be able to be managed by OpenStack do need to be dedicated to running OpenStack pieces. Oh, thank you. All right. The other thing, so VMware officially only supports doing the integration if you're using the NSX stuff that they bought from Nicira as your software-defined networking stack. In practice, you can use Open vSwitch. It works just fine. You do need to make sure that when you're doing your data encapsulation setup, that you can't use GRE, which is usually the default, what most people use for their encapsulation protocol. VMware does not understand that. And so as such, you'll get very very frustrated as trying to get your nodes to talk to each other and to talk to you, and they won't seem to be able to, and that will be why. So you need to use either just the flat networking structure or just or the VLANs. It's gonna take care of you. Oh, look at that, thank you. All right, Hyper-V. How many people have Hyper-V in their environment, just out of curiosity?
Okay, a couple of you guys, it's good.
Why would you ever want to do Hyper-V in your OpenStack environment? Right? The biggest reason that we've seen for our customers is the pricing controls. I mentioned earlier that talking about Hyper-V, that you have the Windows people, once you have that server license for Windows, they can spin up as many instances on there as they want, and it's not going to incur any additional charges. Whereas if they were on, say, KVM or VMware or something like that, they would have to pay the per instance pricing. So as a result, a lot of the Windows administrators want to be able to run their stuff out on Hyper-V because they want to have that cost certainty, right? I've got 10 Hyper-V servers. I have to pay for 10 licenses. I don't have to worry about, you know, counting anything or all that kind of stuff. It's very easy to keep track of, to audit, and to maintain. For you as the OpenStack designer, that means that you need to see if you're going to bring OpenStack into bring that Hyper-V into your OpenStack, which is usually a good idea. To have everything unified under that one umbrella. Then again, we're gonna have to get some other things that come into play here. Again, there's no IP tables on Windows. I don't know if the new Linux-like environment with Bash and stuff like that they're gonna bake into Windows 12 is gonna be able to do that, but that may change at some point. But as of right now, there are no security groups available to you because there's no IP tables. Two NICs are required. So you need to be able to have one NIC is going to be talking to the management framework, and the other NIC is dedicated towards talking for the guests to be able to talk within each other. There is a little bit of confusion on the documentation pages for the OpenStack docs because it says on one line two NICs are required, and then about
the other line says
six inches down lower, there's another one that says
just
when you're running
one, you won't be able to communicate with your Hyper-V. So
okay. Yeah. When you're only running one interface. So this is why. You can do some things to make the one interface work, right? But straight out of the box, you need to have the two, and that's the preferred way of going about it. not a big deal, but it's something to make sure you know.
On the storage side, you need iSCSI initiator. So luckily with a lot of the Ceph stuff, that you can actually activate an iSCSI initiator. If you don't have that, Windows won't know how to communicate with your storage, and it's going to be like, eh. That's actually a technical term.
Yeah.
Feel free to use it.
I use it a lot. Okay. So you need to have enable your iSCSI initiator. No big deal. That's fairly easy to do. You do need to set up the shared nothing migration, live migration manually on the Hyper-V. That's not something that's turned on by default. You do have to go through and enable it, and it's one of those things that kind of got bolted on after the fact. and I'm sure it'll get better as time goes on. You can't do GRE here either. And so you need to, again, use either the flat VLAN, VLAN-X, a different methodology for doing your encapsulation. another thing that we've seen for customers who are rolling this out is taking NUMA spanning and turning that off. It helps to, by reducing the number of choices it has to make in terms of placement because of getting the memory and the CPUs all matched up and all that kind of stuff in the same zones. Turning off the NUMA spanning can save you a lot of performance here on Windows. I don't know how much that's going to impact most people from a day-to-day business, but if you're doing something that's on a fairly large scale with Hyper-V, this is going to make a significant difference for you. The other thing, and this is kind of a roll your eyes kind of moment, but you have to do a 32-bit Python 2.7 on Hyper-V.
64-bit crashes.
What's that?
64-bit crashes.
Yeah, the 64-bit crashes. There's lots of instability in the 64-bit libraries, so you need to do the 32-bit, and it does need to be a Python 2.7. So at some point, hopefully, they will join the modern world. And, well, it's not Microsoft's fault. Somebody will figure out.
We'll blame Microsoft anyway.
Deal. All right. I keep looking back at the screen as if I can't see the see the monitor right here in front of me. It's just a force of habit. I'm not used to having like all the fancy equipment here. This is great. Okay, so, who here is familiar with the networking OSI model right here?
Did you guys know that there's actually two hidden layers?
There's actually two extra layers right here that are not on there. What? I almost blew the next sheesh.
There we go.
Politics and money. Right. If you have a break in the politics of your network, then you are effectively shut down. It's just as much as if somebody ran a backhoe over your fiber optic main. This gets back to what we were talking about with the security groups earlier, where you need to make sure that you are talking to people when you're planning your OpenStack. Network people tend to be very, very touchy about you doing things to their network. Because you know, if there's a network outage or short or anything like that, it impacts everybody, so everybody's going to come screaming to them. If you have one server over in the corner of the data center, there's a good chance that it might not cause a problem if it goes down. But if the network goes down, then all of a sudden there's hell to pay. You know, even the CEO notices that kind of thing.
And they're the ones with the money.
Yeah, and they're the ones with the money. So if they don't fund it, it doesn't happen. So that's my dad's joke, by the way. it's a dad joke. Try that again. Next up is choosing an OpenStack vendor. And this gets a little bit touchy. I don't want this to be sounding like it's a marketing thing where we're coming up here and saying, hey, go buy SUSE, which we would love for you to be able to do.
Please go buy SUSE.
Please go buy SUSE. But even if you don't buy us, buy from somebody. And the reason for that, and again, this is my dad's quote as well, Linux is free as long as your time is worth nothing to you. The same thing applies to OpenStack, right? You are always paying for it in one way or another. It may be because you pay a subscription fee to us or one of our competitors or something like that to have it out there. That's great. If you're doing it in-house, that means you need to have a higher trained staff on board, right? Because it requires a higher level of expertise to be able to dive into all these kinds of things. Those type of people are not the most easy kind of people to find. It's very difficult to find people that are up to that level. And as a result, the ones that are that are at that level tend to move around a lot because people keep offering them more money to go do something for them. So in that case, then your capital costs are going to be going up because, is it capital? I can't remember. I'm not, my wife's the MBA, not me. I can't remember these things. Your money going out the door
capital
goes up.
Capital investitures.
I can't remember if it's CapEx or OpEx. I'm not good with that stuff. Any case, the money going out the door increases, right? Because you have to pay these people additional money, you have to have additional benefits for them, you have to make concessions into your workflows for these people because they're generally the type of eccentric type genius people that that do weird things that nobody else understands, kind of stuff. So there is a cost, a very real cost, for doing this stuff on your own. And the other thing that comes into play here is this is not your core competency, right? This is, for the most part, unless you're like an OpenStack vendor like us or somebody else, 5 minutes? Okay. Unless you're an OpenStack vendor like us or somebody else, this is not what you do to make money and to be in business. Don't waste time doing things that are not your core competency. Bring somebody in that can work with you, that can help you with the training and from the implementation and the maintenance and whatnot to make life easier. The corollary to that quote, by the way, is that OpenStack is not free as in beer, free as in speech, it's free as in puppy. Has anybody here gotten a free puppy?
Anybody ever raised a puppy? I've got two dogs. I got That's one, right. She's a year and a half now, and she's 127 pounds. This is true.
It is not cheap to raise a puppy. Okay, and that is actually my quote, so I keep pointing it over the screen like that's going to make a difference. There we go. Okay, so we'll move right along. We've taken up too much of the time already. We're going too slow. So SUSE sponsored a study a couple months ago about enterprise OpenStack adoption, and there's some really neat things that came out of it. And I was going to put, I even got a hold of the study so I could put some of the graphs and stuff like that into this presentation. I always pulled them up, and they were about the ugliest looking graphs that you ever saw in your life. So we decided to stick with text instead. But there are two key things that we wanted to pull out. 86% of the people that responded said that the lack of skills in the market is making their companies reluctant to pursue private cloud. Is that true for your company?
Wow. A lot of you, yeah.
Okay, I expected more hands than that. In addition, 78% of companies that have yet to adopt private cloud are doing it specifically because of that skills shortage. Again, that comes into the whole, those types of people are hard to find. And they're difficult to retain. So by working with a vendor, then you can you can offset some of that by having the high-level engineering expertise be something that we take care of. And just to very quickly finish up here, the other reason for getting a vendor is because you'll have many organizations, you have existing SLAs, and this actually comes into your choice of vendor as well. You need to make sure that your specific vendor has a support organization in place that is capable of doing rapid turnaround on complex issues that may involve OS, hardware, and the OpenStack bits themselves. obviously, we feel like we do this very well, and this is one of the things that we bring to the table. And really, when you're paying for these kind of things, whether it's Linux or OpenStack, this is the one thing that you're paying for, and you want to make sure that you actually get good.
Another thing is compliance with government regulations. So yep. If you know you're working for a state or national government, you got to make sure you have your certifications, and then finally your hardware and software certifications, so you know that your stuff is going to run. Because yep. if your CEO doesn't have proof that your hardware is going to be okay and your software is going to be okay, he's not going to dish out the money.
Yep. So fist bump, baby. Thinks that you're awesome. You guys are great. Now you're all ready to go out there and do your enterprise OpenStack implementation.
So, thank you guys
thank
so
you very much.
Much
for your time, guys.